हरि ओम लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द प्रेयर ओम समस्त जन कल्याणी निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं त्वमेव माता च पिता त्वमेव त्वमेव बंधुश्च सखा त्वमेव त्वमेव विद्या द्रविडं त्वमेव त्वमेव सर्वं मम देव देव त्वमेव सर्वं गुरुदेव देव हरि ओम वी आर डिस्कसिंग द ईश्वर स्वरूपम मीन्स व्हाट इज द नेचर ऑफ ईश्वर आफ्टर वी फिनिश द डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द जीव स्वरूपम एंड वी वांट टू नो the Ishvara because Jiva, Jagat, Ishvara all projections from the totality which is Brahman. So Brahman itself appears as both Jiva, Jagat and Ishvara. And therefore when we equate essentially Tattvamasi, we are equating the essence of the Jiva, the essence of Jagat and the essence of Ishvara. So we should know the Jiva aspect and the Ishvara aspect as well as the Jagat aspect, and all this is involved in clear understanding of who am I, or essentially the understanding of Aham Brahmasmi. So Brahma Atma Aikya Bodhena Moksha Siddhyati Nanyatha. So because until I understand the identity or oneness that pervades of Atma and Brahman, there is no moksha, there is no liberation or freedom. Because freedom involves the free from all divisions, and Jiva, Jagat, Ishvara are the divisions, and divisionlessness or divisionless state is only Brahman. And how the divisions came into picture and what is the essence of these divisions also need to be understood, because we have to understand that since we are already seeing the divisions, and from the divisions we have to see what that pervades the one that is divisionless. And therefore we are examining what is Ishvara. But until we are coming to this Jnana Marg, we have considered that we are only a Jiva and Ishvara is the Lord. There is a Upasana, Karma Yoga that involves a glorification of the Ishvara. And from that point, we also should know what is Ishvara. Also, we should know that when we talk about Avatara, that is Lord Himself coming down, or Jivan Mukta, the one who is climbing up and recognizing I am Brahman. What exactly is the difference? Am I Ishvara or am I Brahman? And when I say I am Ishvara, what exactly we are talking about Ishvara's aspect of it, or the essence that we are equating? All this has to be clear, because the criticism or commentary about against Advaita is, how can you be Ishvara? So I am not Ishvara, or what exactly I am not and what exactly I am also has to be clear. So we are taking the Mundakopanishad slokas that are 6, 7, 8 and 9, describe beautifully the nature of Ishvara and the creation also aspect. And we went through that, and it says essentially creation, three examples are given. It says yatha yathor nana bisrujati grunhate cha yatha prithivyam moshadayah sambhavanti yatha satah purushad keshalomani see tatha aksharat sambhavati ha vishwam. Just as the spider putting forth the net, where that example is used for srushti, sthiti, laya, because the spider creates its own net and he is an intelligent as well as a material cause, and also it absorbs back that thread that it creates, therefore it's laya karanam too. So that example is provided to show that the nimitta upadana karanam, the intelligent cause and the material cause, abhinnam means non-difference, it's the same cause appearing as both. Yatha prithivyam moshadayah sambhavanti, just as the earth, one earth producing many varieties of things, so whole thing is the life is coming from the earth only. So therefore I can have that various things which are different, which are of different types, are coming from one source. And that's why same art, when we put the seed of an apple, we are getting an apple seed, and when we put mango seed, we get a mango trees. Same water, same earth, but the seed converts that part into, depending upon the individual vasanas, the expression becomes different, even though source is there. That's what urdhvamoola madashyakam, one moolam, and from which the whole branches are coming, and that's what is the तथा अक्षरात् संभवतीह विश्वम. एंड थर्ड एग्जाम्पल वाज यथा सतः पुरुषात् केशलोमानि, फ्रॉम अ कॉन्शियस लिविंग एंटिटी प्रोड्यूसिंग द अनकॉन्शियस एंटिटी दैट इज नेल्स एंड हेयर व्हिच वी नॉर्मली वी कट इट, दैट मीन्स देयर इज नो लाइफ इन दैट. And therefore, lifeless thing or inert things can come out from the conscious entity. And that is an example to illustrate that. So all that examples provided. And we also discuss a better example, in fact, is the Mandukya Karika Upanishad, that talks about the dream example, and the dream example, the dream creation, where I am both intelligent cause, I am as the waker mind, with the waker mind, both the intelligent cause as well as the material cause, because I am not taking material from outside into my dream to create rivers and hills and all that. But for a dreamer, it is not the imagination, it is a real. For a dreamer, while dreaming, it's not a dream for him, it is a real world. Only a waker says about the dream, but not a dreamer doesn't say that it's not a real. So one has to be careful. Says from what reference we are talking about unreality, and from what reference it's real. Because Advaita says everything is unreal. Advaita says everything is real from the Paramarthika point. From the transactional point, they are real because they are transactionally real, but not absolutely real. And that we call it as mithya. And now, in the next sloka, on the sloka 8, the creation process of stages has been defined by the Upanishad. It says, tapasa achiyate brahma, tataha annam abhijayate, annat pranaha manaha satyam, and lokaha karmasu cha amrutam. So from the tapasa, by doing tapas, the Brahman is chiyate. Tapasa means, it's not really austerity that we understand. Tapasa means an intellectual visualization of the whole creation process based on the vasanas that are there of all the jivas that are in the subtle form. It says what kind of world is required, or what kind of worlds are required to exhaust the vasanas of all the jivas that are in the potential form that are there, just as we have a laya at the individual level and pralaya at the global level. And therefore, with the projection is tapasa, is visualization before the creation starts, and that is done by Ishvara. So that the stage of visualization is chiyate, also expands, means he crystallizes those ideas, and tataha annam abhijayate. So that from which the whole, the panchabhutas and everything else is coming from that, this tataha annam abhijayate. This lo annat pranaha manaha satyam. So from annat here, annam is the Hiranyagarbha. And from the Hiranyagarbha, that means the firstborn, and then from the firstborn, annat pranaha. Pranaha means essentially the whole creation process. And so the annam is, tataha annam means the causal state, karana sariram, and from that Hiranyagarbha is pranaha, and manaha is essentially the total knowledge that is required for the creation. This is a transactional knowledge that is required. So sarvasaktiman we call it, and that's what is manaha. And satyam is both all the panchabhutas, both that have form and that are formless. Akasha is formless, Vayu is formless, and rest of the three having form, and that includes all that called Satyam. And Lokaha, and 14 Lokas, and Karmasu, and using the karma, that is essentially the good or bad, Punyam and Papam. And we discuss that there are moral laws that create the Punyam and Papam. So only the the other laws that are applicable in the transactional world is different from the moral laws, and that depends upon the motivation that we discussed before. Just as when the doctor is cutting the body, his motivation is different from a murderer cutting the body. So the action may be same, but the motivation determines the results, or the punyam and papam, which is called adrushtam. It cannot be seen, but it has an effect, and people suffer for whatever is not, people are not unnecessarily suffering for anything. Whatever they undergo is because of the results of the previous actions, and you are accountable for your own actions. So if I don't want to suffer in future, so make sure that I act properly so that the results will be appropriate. And that's what is called punyam and papam. And so karma sucha amrutam. Amrutam here means the results of the action. So all that is provided as a part of Ishvara, and all that is visualized, and that is called jnanam. So that is essentially chiyate, expands, and that is tapasa. Tapasa means having a clear and clear knowledge of what he is going to create, and that's what is implied in that sloka. So next we'll take the sloka 9 that defines the Brahman in terms of the creation process. It says, Yaha sarvajnaha sarvavit yasya jnanamayam tapaha tasmat etat brahma namarupam annam cha jayate. Let's repeat. Yaha sarvajnaha sarvavit yasya jnanamayam tapaha tasmat etat brahma namarupam annam cha jayate. So this is, he is defining now, or swarupam of the Ishvara here. That's very interesting here. So yaha sarvajnaha sarvavit. The two words are used, although they look like a synonyms. So sarvajnaha, all knowing. So one who is going to create has to have all knowledge of the whole creation. So if I am going to make a pot, I am ghatam. So ghatasya karta ghatajna. I should know how to make a pot. If I am building a house, I should know how to build it. So knowledge of that, and I have to have a clear visualization, it's called blueprints, is what is essentially tapasa involved. That means crystallization of the whole creation and complete visualization of what I am going to create. That's what Lord also. And whole universe is getting created, and universe consists of the physical laws and the physical material, as well as the conscious beings of BMIs and so on, and all that is visualized, and that's what essentially yaha sarvajnaha. So all the laws or knowledge of everything is known, but here sarvajnaha sarvavit. Sarvajnaha means all knowledge, and sarvavit is knower of everything. So both mean the same, but here the Upanishad is differentiating, obviously for some reason, because this chapter started is a paravidya and aparavidya. What is the paravidya, supreme knowledge, and aparavidya, and the transactional worldly knowledge? That means knowledge of all the physical laws and everything else. Therefore, Ishvara is sarvajnaha. Sarvajnaha therefore stands for paravidya. That means he knows that he is not a samsari. He knows the absolute truth. I am Satchidananda Swarupam. He has clear understanding, and that is called sarvajnaha. Because eka vijnanena sarva vijnanam bhavati. That's what his this statement is. Because the Mundaka Upanishad itself starts with the student asking, Hey Bhagavan, kasmin no bhagavo vijnate sarvamidam vijnatam bhavati. Knowing that, by which I will know everything, and that knowledge is sarvajnatvam. So if you go to temple, they do ashtottara nama, from which the chanting of the names of the Lord, and you will see all these words. Om is a sarvajnaha, he is sarvashaktiman. So he is knowledge of everything, and here sarvajnaha means knowledge of the absolute nature of Brahman, knowing which he knows everything else, and that's what is called sarvajnaha. and sarvavit also, knowing everything also. Here sarvavit correspond to this aparavidya, that means all others knowledge that doesn't involve the absolute knowledge. That means all relative knowledge, that means he knows everything in the universe, and that's why he is called sarvavit. So this Ishvara is not only knowing the paravidya, he knows the aparavidya also. Anything that is in the universe, a scientist doesn't invent a law, he only discovers the law that's already there. So already there, because the one who created has to know what that law is. So he is the expert in all fields, in every field also he is the expert, because he is the one who created all fields also. Even that are discovered and yet to be discovered. You can create many, many sciences, and each science in depth, and you can keep on investigating. As we said, you know more and more about less and less, and less and less about everything else. And that's what is essentially for a human being. But he knows more and more about everything also. And that's called sarvavit. So now you can see, what's the difference between a jnani and a Ishvara? So when I realize that I am Brahman, so what do I gain? I gain sarvajnatvam, that means ekavidya, that is one knowing which I know everything. That is, I know only paravidya. That's what the student is asking in the Mundaka Upanishad, and that's what teacher is trying to teach also in the... Therefore, what a Jeevan Mukta will know only the Sarvajnatvam, but he will not know Sarvavitu. He cannot be Sarvavitu. So, Jeevan Mukta is different from Ishvara. That has to be very clear, because I am, Advaita Vedanta says, the Jeeva is nothing but Ishvara. What they are equating is only from the Sarvajnatvam point, that is from the nature of understanding Aham Brahmasmi, that point only, but not in the transactional world. So Shankara may be a Sarvajna, but he may not know quantum mechanics, or he may not know. If he wants to know, he can easily learn, because of his sharp intellect, he can learn anything that he wants, if he wants it. But at the same time, what is a Jnani or a Jeevan Mukta is the one who is Sarvajnaha but not Sarvavitu. Therefore, Ishvara and the Jnani differ. Jnani is going upwards, and he is, you cannot be Sarvavitu, because we said the more you know, the less and less we will be knowing in terms of everything else, and because we are looking about the smaller and smaller super specialist in any field. Therefore, I can never become Sarvavitu in the objective world using the local mind, which is finite. Whereas the Ishvara is a total involved, total mind of all people also is his mind, and therefore he can know anything, and that's why he is a Sarvavitu. That are discovered and yet to be discovered also he knows. And therefore, the difference between a Jeevan Mukta and Ishvara has to be understood. So the Advaitin doesn't say that I am Ishvara. Advaitin says I am Brahmasmi, and Ishvara is also Brahman. Therefore I am Ishvara in that category, not from the point of all things that we are discussing about the Ishvara's qualifications versus the Jiva's qualifications. So in the case of equation, that Tattvamasi, we have to separate that which is distinguishing features of Jiva and Ishvara, and only equate the essence of it, the substratum, or the one that pervades everything, that alone has to be equated. So that's what is called Bhagatyaga Lakshanam, or Samanadhikaranam involving Bhagatyagam. That means Hajahal Lakshana also it's called. And this is means you are giving up something and only taking other part and equating that part. And that's what is the example here. So here Sarvajnaha Sarvavitu. So we have now clear understanding how Ishvara differs from Jeevan Mukta. So yaha sarvajnaha sarvavitu yasya jnanamayam tapaha. So this tapas or the knowledge is in the austerity is in the form of a knowledge only. So he mentioned about tapas. Now he is giving more definition in terms of it is jnanamayam. It is complete knowledge of how one should create or what kind of creation is required to exhaust the vasanas of all beings in 14 lokas we are talking about, and their interrelation between the jivas and all that, tamashti vasanas and vyashti vasanas, all that he has to take into consideration, and that's why he is arvavita also. And that's what is the nature of Ishvara. So tasmat etad brahma nama rupam annansa jayate. So tasmat etad brahma, this the Aksharam Brahma, that which is indestructible, Brahman, that is infinite, that which cannot undergo any creation by itself, but at the same time appears to be creation, and therefore here it is defining clearly what exactly is the creation. Is it real or unreal? This is Nama Rupam Annam Cha. So, see, Annam here is food here. So, Namam Rupam and Annam. Annam is food is also created, and Namam and Rupam. Namam is the name and Rupam is the form. So, name and forms are created in the universe. So, every object is nothing but Nama and Rupa. What is the substance? Substance is only Brahman. See, that tasmad etad brahma jayate. He is becoming many in these forms of nama and rupa. So we have to be very careful here. When I say I am seeing the world, I cannot see the substantive of the world, because substantive is Brahman and it is imperceptible. What is substantive? Substantive is Brahman. And what's a Brahman? Is the nature of the pure existence. And all other things that you talk about, the properties of gold is different from properties of iron, which is different from properties of something else. But each property depends upon the packaging. Packaging is name and a form. So that's essentially, even from science point also, nothing but electrons, protons and neutrons only. And they are looking for what are the more fundamental particles. But they are only assemblies of that into different nama rupas. Rupa means form. Form includes all attributes of the object. So when I perceive an object, I am only perceiving nama rupa only, because the substantive according to Vedanta is Brahman only, and Brahman is imperceptible. Because if I take the any object, say object, says if I have a watch here, it says watch does it exist? Yes, there is an existence, but I cannot see the existence, but because of which watch itself exists. So existence itself appearing in the watch form. Form belongs to the form, attributes, qualities, utilities, all that belong to the form itself and not to this substance which is existence. And this we'll analyze a little bit, because when we say I am seeing the world, we have to have a clear understanding of what exactly I am seeing, and the reality of that also has to be understood. We'll stop here. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.